Open your Bibles, if you will, to 2 Timothy chapter 2. As it was read in your hearing, in a broader sense, today I want to invite your attention to two verses of this text in 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 20, verses 20 through 22. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 20 and 22. The text reads, "But in a great house there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also wood and clay, some for honor and some for dishonor. Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from the latter, he will be a vessel for honor, sanctified and useful for the master, prepared for every good work." Verse 22, "Flee also youthful lusts, but pursue righteousness, faith, love, peace, with those who call upon the name of the Lord out of a pure heart." I'm going to stop right here. There's so much in this text, I can't do it all in one. But these verses that we've just read, verses 20, 21, and 22, are the verses, the foundation for our time together this morning. I want to talk to you on a subject this morning, a vessel God can use. A vessel that God can use. All of us desire to be used of the Lord. Desire a life that is pleasing to the Lord. All of us don't understand what that really looks like in practical terms. But we're growing to understand what God's will is for our lives. So that we can have this type of experience. And so that God can get glory again out of our lives. A vessel that God can use. And before I go into the text this morning and unpack these verses, let's just pause right here, if you will, and pray. But I'm going to do this a different way. Would you just take about a minute and 30 seconds and just pray and talk to God yourself? I know you used to hear me pray over the message, but would you pray over this word for you within your own heart and that God might speak to you as his vessel? Father, I ask that you would use this moment to do what brings glory to your name in the hearts and minds and lives of everyone present here today. And I pray, oh God, nothing would restrict you or hinder you from showing us what it is you want us to see. And allow us to align ourselves with your perfect will for our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. A vessel God can use. Here in this text, verse 20 begins to describe for us, first of all, what a vessel is. You and I need to understand that we are vessels. All of us are vessels. Matter of fact, everyone in the world is a vessel. Everyone in the world, saved and unsaved, all vessels. Because the text unfolds us in verse 20, that there are vessels of honor and there are vessels of dishonor. In other words, there are vessels that have a special purpose attached to their existence. And there are regular, ordinary, generic vessels. As you might go to the pharmacy, you'll discover that there are medication with name brand. There's also non-name brand medication. We find that in every facet of life. Maybe it's a shoe. Maybe it's a clothing piece. And you'd rather go and pay extra money for the name brand when the no-name clothing will keep you just as warm. But we get so attached to a certain style, a certain name, not even about the content or the character of it, it's about the name that it's attached to, that really adds value to it. And that's been our experience on an earthly level. But I want you to understand that spiritually speaking, God looks at us today as vessels. Vessels. All kinds of vessels. All sorts. That's the first thing. I want you to see the sort of vessels that are. In a great house, there are vessels of gold and silver, but also wood and earth. Some for honor, some for dishonor. Beloved, this world is described here as having all kinds of people with different types of character. Some good, some bad, some saved, some lost, some striving to live their lives for the Lord, some that are chasing after the world, the flesh, and the devil. You've got all kinds. All kinds. Let me ask you the question this morning as we look at the sort of vessels that Paul is describing. Because what sort of vessel are you? What sort of vessel are you? Do you understand? Do we understand what God wants to do in our lives and what he wants to do through our lives? You understand a vessel is not just to contain, but yet it is. But that vessel, while it contains, is to be used to pour out. It's to be used to bless someone else, to meet a need. And you and I have to understand what kind of vessel God really wants to use and why he wants to use us this way. Let's go further this morning as we gain a heart of understanding about these vessels that we find in verse 20. The second thing we see in this chapter is not only the sort of vessels, but the separation of the vessels. The separation of the vessels. If a man, verse 21, if a man therefore purges himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified, and meet for the master's use, and prepared unto every good work. Now, that's a lot. Let's go back and unpack it. He draws a distinction here from verse 21, or rather verse 20 to 21. The end of verse 20, he says, there are some for honor and some for dishonor. The Bible says that as he begins to move further into the purpose of these vessels, he refers back to the last thing he said in verse 20. The vessels of dishonor. And he says, if you, in verse 21, if you cleanse yourself from the latter, from the vessels of dishonor, so there is a separation that the text is giving to us today. God wants all of us, you and I, to be vessels or people of honor. In other words, our lives must praise and reflect well and speak well of Jesus Christ, the one we represent. Just like that name tag on that garment represents the maker. You and I are made in the image of Christ. But then secondly, at salvation, you and I have the blood applied to our lives. That's the first way of identifying. Then we have the Holy Spirit that lives on the inside of us, that seals us unto the day of redemption. That's the other way of identifying us as Christ followers, as people of the Lord, people of honor. He says, listen, our lives must be lived in such a way that we actually and practically honor God. He says, we must be sanctified. Look at the verse. Verse 21. He says, vessels of honor, sanctified. Sanctified means to be what? Set apart. Sanctified. Literally set apart for a specific task and duty. Giving a priority to something versus everything else. Set apart for a unique purpose. That is who you and I are today. We have been saved, cleansed, forgiven, and set apart exclusively for the purpose that God has for our lives. Now, as we unpack that and begin to digest that, we began to have a totally different realization and acknowledgement of how we're really to live life. You see, there are a lot of Christians today that don't accept this term sanctification, because they resist the very fact that God wants to change them just for him. You see, a lot of us want to be saved, but continue. And God says, no, 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 no. See, what I do through the blood that is shed, and what I do, what I did through the cross, and what I'm doing through the power and the infilling of the Spirit of God in your life is so that you can be exclusively mine. You know how it is when you're in a relationship. You don't want nobody else coming into that. No, that's you and that person. It is an exclusive relationship. And what God's saying is, I'm no different. Matter of fact, I'm a jealous God. That's why in Israel he said, listen, I don't have any other gods before me. Why? Because I'm jealous. I want exclusive rights to you and you alone. I don't want your mentality to be divided. I don't want your mind to be divided. I don't want your heart to be divided. I want you to be completely mine. If I am going to sacrifice my life, give you my best, shed my blood, lay aside my deity momentarily to come, my powers as God to come down and to be like you. Amen. If I'm going to make that commitment to you, oh, you got to make a commitment to me. Amen. And here's the reality of this, of being the type of vessel that God wants us to be. He demands that you and I are set apart for his glory. Separation seems to be such a misunderstood term today. Sanctification is almost a term that we don't even use anymore. Everybody wants to use favor. Everybody wants to talk about blessings. Everybody wants to talk about increase. You know, we have certain catchphrases today that are popular in our Christian world, but nobody's talking about sanctification anymore. Years ago, it was that in the Pentecostal movement that the old time preachers would preach holiness or hell. And that way they didn't have too many bells and whistles, but that's what the old preachers would stand and preach. Heaven or hell, holiness or hell. They would have a straight perspective about really what matters. In order to be God's child, you got to be holy. In order to be a God, honoring the God, you've got to be sanctified. That became a household term in Pentecostal circles and Church of God in Christ. And go back and do the research. And while we differ with some of their theology, it is still right to preach and to hold to a proper understanding of sanctification. Matter of fact, it would do us some good in this contemporary age to go back and understand that God still says, be ye holy as I am holy. Still in the book. It's still in the Holy Writ. It is still God's authority, authoritative word to us today. He has not changed. And the vessel he wants ultimately for you and I to become is a vessel that is sanctified. Untouched by the world. Untarnished by the world. Now realize that that's not how you and I start. That's not where you and I begin. That's not our story of our origin. Matter of fact, if we'll be honest today, we have been vessels of dishonor. We were born in a dirty clay pot. We were born in a flesh that is dirty, stained by sin. Yes. With no desire whatsoever to please God. With no power to please God. With no mind to please God. No will to please God. And that's how we were born. That's how we started. But what God is saying to us today, he has made a change in the way we began. You see, it's not how you start. It's how you finish. And some of us have been distracted by the past, distracted by our failures, distracted by our problems, and we have failed to understand that God still has a desire and a design for the vessel that he wants us to be. You see, God's got a picture in mind. God's got a plan in his heart. God's got an agenda that he is actually unfolding right before our eyes, and that is the process of sanctification. Not a person in this room that is not a part of that class. You say, I didn't sign up for that class. Yes, you did. When you say, Jesus, come into my heart, be my Lord and Savior, you signed up for Sanctification 101. You are enrolled. You have a seat. He knows your name, your number. He knows your heart. He knows what you've done in the past. But yet, he still says, you qualify for this course. Because I'm doing something different in your life. You were a vessel of dishonor. You were a regular, ordinary, unimportant, nothing special going on type of vessel. But when Jesus came, and matter of fact, here's what adds value to your life and mine, is when we said yes to Jesus and the Holy Spirit came in and occupied. Yeah. Come on, talk to me. You and I have something priceless on the inside. You and I have the power and the person. You see, this is not like the Old Testament experience where the Holy Spirit would come upon the saints and then leave. But you and I have the assurance that he indwells us eternally. Never to leave us. Value. Oh, I don't know who your designers are. I don't know what label you go after. I don't know what kind of clothing you have to have. But Jesus adds value to my life.
Amen.
And if you think about it, Jesus adds value to your life. Doesn't matter what your past has been. Doesn't matter what kind of vessel you were. You have been made anew. You have been washed. You have been cleansed. You have been made a purpose to have a purpose and a design that is totally and exclusively God. See, what we do with junk, we discard it. We throw it away. We end its existence. We out of sight, in trash can, gone, forgot about it. But what God does, he takes vessels and he makes them anew. And he's committed to the plan of making us a vessel he can use. But here's what he says for you and I. Separate yourself. Now, this message might be a little tough. Because it calls for us to actually understand what God is calling for us to do practically. Separate yourself from the ladder. Separate yourself from the vessels of dishonor so that you can understand now the purpose that God has for your life. You see, you can't stay where you've always been and get what God has for you. You can't, I'm saying it again. You can't stay where you've always been and actually get what God has for you. There has to be a coming apart. There has to be a separation. There has to be the work and the practical outworking of sanctification in your life and in my life for us to really fully understand what God is up to in our lives. And the fallacy is, and the problem is for many of us, that we come into a brand new year bringing the same fallacies with us. And God says, no, leave that junk where it was. Actually, if you throw away anything, throw that away. Let me come up with the heavenly trash can and take that away from you so that you can actually have a new experience and understanding of what sanctification really looks like. The verse goes on and says, sanctify and meet for the master's use, or fit for the master's use. Fit. You see, we were not fit apart from what God has done in our lives. But now he's making us fit, usable, and prepared unto every good work. Sanctification is the beginning of that process. But the second part says this type of life leads to preparation. Preparation for what? You see, the pot, like I told you before, is not just a container. But that pot is to be used. That pot has a you flip it over, whatever's in it, it's going to come out. You wonder why a lot of stuff goes on in our world, in our lives. See, it's not about what comes against you or what comes at you or what you experience. It's about what God has put in you. Because under the most stressful and discouraging situations and painful situations in our lives, God is still doing something on the inside. And when God gets ready to use you, no matter how you feel about yourself or your world or your scenarios, listen, God has something in you, and as long as there's something that God is doing inside of you, the Bible says he's going to complete the work that he started in us. There's something he's doing on the inside of our vessel that is going to give him glory. And see, that's the thing that we need to stay focused on this morning. It's not what comes on the exterior. It's not what's coming at us. The enemy is going to be an enemy. But let's take some time and put some emphasis on what God's doing on the inside. We don't look up. We don't look at that too much today. We need to spend some time. God, what are you doing in my life? Because listen, the enemy only attacks from the outside because he knows there's a threat on the inside. I want y'all to get this morning. What God has done that is of value in your life is of destroy that vessel. God says, I won't let it happen. Because I'm committed to the work that I've started in you. And you might be cracked, but I'm going to keep you together. You might be flawed and think at any moment I'm going to leak, but he's going to hold you together. You might think that you have a proper perspective and understanding of your limitations and breaking point. But let me tell you something. It's not the clay. It's not the vessel that's keeping the vessel. It's not because the vessel has the strength. It's who is actually holding it. You and I need to understand God's committed to what he's doing on the inside of us so much so he's not going to let us fall apart. That's the commitment of God to us today. And that's why he says, listen, if you and I have that same understanding, then actually cooperate with God's sanctifying work in your life. Don't kick against God's sanctifying work in your life, because he's separating you not so you can be weird and strange and some weirdo that no one wants to be around. No, he's actually got something great he wants to do in your life. But you've got to get to a point where you can hear him and him alone. I got a nephew that gone into the military. And the first thing that he had to do was leave home. First thing he had to do was go where the military said go. First thing he had to do was leave his civilian life. And to understand, if I want to be a part of the military, I've got to submit to what they're doing right now. And the first thing was to separate yourself from everybody else that you think you know and love and care about.
That's right.
They'll still be there, but I've got to have exclusive rights to you. Uncle Sam says, I've got to have exclusive rights to you. Because why? I've got to reprogram the way you think. Before you try to do anything for the United States of America in any type of military aspect, you've got to have a different mindset. You got to have a different understanding. You got to have a different way of looking at things and operating. You got to have a different way of life. And God says the same thing this morning.
Amen.
I'm separating you not to ruin you. I'm separating you not to discourage you. But I'm separating you because I've got a plan of honor. I've got a plan that is great for your life. I want you to be a vessel that I can really use. I don't want you to be ordinary in any area of your life.
That's right.
And I fear that many of us today settle for being ordinary because that's acceptable. Everyone else is ordinary. Everyone else is run-of-the-mill. Everyone else is nothing special about them, just doing what they do. But God says, that's not why I saved you. That's not why I redeemed you. I redeemed you. I gave you the Holy Spirit. I gave you my power, my promises, because there's something special I want to do in your life. And I want you to understand that this morning, you and I are vessels that are being sanctified, set apart, and prepared for life. You see, you prepare yourself academically, you prepare yourself financially, you prepare yourself in so many different ways, but this, the only way you can really be prepared is to let God lead you. Because he knows his plan for your life.
Yes, he does.
You see, last Sunday we talked about stepping out of the boat. We talked about hearing God's call, his authorization for changes and shifts and transitions in life, which will come. But following him through those transitions, that's the key. And here it is again. He prepares us, but we have to allow him that advantage in our lives. Like a soldier, like a young soldier goes to boot camp. Don't be afraid of boot camp, church. Don't be afraid of boot camp. See, I want everything to be comfortable in my life. I want to like everything in my life. I want to enjoy everything in my life. There might be some seasons of your life where he does have you in an uncomfortable spot. But let me tell you something. God is not trying to ruin your life. He's not trying to end your life. He's not trying to take anything away from you. Matter of fact, he's into multiplication.
Yes. Yes.
He wants to multiply his blessings upon you. You see, Satan comes, what, to steal, kill, and destroy. He's in the division. God is in the multiplication. He's, I've come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. Multiplication. He wants to give you more than you can ever imagine. He wants to bless you in a greater way than you've ever lived through. He wants to give you stuff that you don't even have the sense to ask for now in great quantities.
Jesus, amen.
Reality of the matter is that most Christians Christians today don't see God that way. We see the struggle. We see the pain. We see the discomfort. And we say it will never be anything but ordinary. And some of us even get to the point where we just want to, what's the use of being a vessel of the Lord? Depression, discouragement, despondency, despair. Oh, those tricks of the enemy come in and further crack the pot. When God has a design for you just like you are, because he's taking you somewhere. Say that with me. He's taking me somewhere. Come on, say it like you mean it. He's taking me somewhere. Because he wants me to be a vessel he can use. But look at verse 22. Not only did we look at the vessel in verse 20 and 21, but look at verse 22. Let's look at the virtue of this vessel. Verse 22 says this. Flee also youthful lust, but pursue righteousness, faith, love, peace with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. Amen. I want you to see this. The virtue, and this might surprise some of us because we don't look at this as being a virtue. Or a good thing. The first thing he said in verse 22 is what? What's the first word?
Flee.
Say it. What is it?
Flee.
Flee. Flee. What does flee mean? I'm not talking about something that goes to a dog. Now, what is a flee? What, how do we flee?
Run.
We run. It means to run. That is the first virtue we find in this text. The first good thing. The first great thing, gracious thing, is the most important thing we could take away from this text today. Flee! He says, flee also youthful lust. Yeah. Now let's pause for a minute. Again, to run is a virtue. To run is a virtue. It's one of the best Christian virtues we can have.
Amen.
But many of us look at this running as being coward, being scared,
right,
operating in fear. Let me clear that up. God is not telling us to run in fear. You hear me? He's not telling in this text to run in fear. Because of fear, because we're scared and we don't know what to do. So we run, panic, run. No, that's not what this is.
No.
Paul says, listen, flee youthful lust. In other words, run or have an understanding that this is not the order that God has for you.
Amen.
And separate yourself with an urgency, because it will diminish the value that God is placing on your life. Just as you, again, buy that name brand garment and you go to Starbucks and you thought the cap was on good and you begin, and what, it begins to fall and drip all over your nice garment that you paid whatever for, probably overpaid for. You need to go Ross and get it at half price. Yeah, I know about Ross. Thank you, sweetheart. I know about Ross. Why pay full price? That's a commercial. All right. But you know how it is when you have an accident like that on something expensive. Now, my sweatshirts and jeans you might not care about, but if it's something and you're going somewhere that night and you spill something on what you are prepared to go somewhere with, you have a different reaction to that. You will try to clean it up, correct it in a hurry. Why? Because you're going somewhere.
Amen.
Y'all come on and walk with me this morning. All I'm trying to tell you is that your life and my life are going somewhere. God has a purpose for taking us through where we are to take us where he wants us to be. We're on our way somewhere. And it's important that we understand the value. Even when we get to a point where we deal with struggles and stress and lust and temptation, whatever it might be.
Oh, yes.
And reality is all of us are going to have, will, and will continue to go through stress and trials and temptation.
Oh, yes.
But here's what you do. You get your running shoes on. And you run.
Yes.
You flee. You make a decision. God's not going to make you.
That's right.
You and I have to understand and clue in on this. What God is doing in my life is more valuable than anything else in life. And I must cooperate with what God is doing in my life, because he's taking me somewhere and I don't want to jeopardize the journey.
Amen.
Not that he's going to kick you off the bus. No, but you're going to be late when God says you ought to be here. Because you're tangled up, tied up in things that are not a part of God's plan for your life.
That's right.
We talk about this in Sunday school. We got to be honest with ourselves. Yeah. One of the greatest things that it's not even about knowing theology. It's not about knowing everything there is to know about the Bible. It's about knowing ourselves.
Yes.
Many of us are not even honest with, number one, we're not honest with where we are. And so therefore, we can't even respond appropriately when the text says, flee youthful lust. We don't even know where we are. And many of us think we can handle it. First of all, fallacy in the morning. Yeah. You think you can handle it. The Bible says pride goes before a fall. And if we in our ignorance think we can handle those areas that are not God's will in our life, you and I are setting ourselves up for failure. And here's what he says. Here's what you and I ought to do as believers. Put our running shoes on and actually flee. Don't run to it. Don't run into it. Run to Jesus. Run to God's word. Run back to God's will for your life. See, I don't know if fleeing or running was a virtue. You know what? You take your football team, whether it be Redskins, Cowboys, or whoever else, or any other sporting event, basketball, baseball. One of the common denominators in all these sports, in all these areas of sport, is the art of running. If you take running out of sports, think about it for a minute. Think about how stupid it would be to look at your TV. Can you imagine? Two big Husker guys, football team, out there on the field, and nobody running. Basketball! Pass me the ball! And nothing happens! Our expectation in these arenas is that once you get the ball, you run. You actually, and you run in the right direction. Lord have mercy. Let me qualify that. It's not just running anywhere. You got to know where to run too. And that's a teachable moment right here. I can preach right there. We got to know where to run. We need to know where to run. God has given us this opportunity. He says, listen, I'll give you a way of escape. I'll give you an exit. I'll always guarantee you an exit. With your life situations, with your issues, with your pressure, with your stress, I'll always, just like there's always a light on. This world has never been without a light. And this world, you and I, our world has never been without a door. And I'm talking about how God providentially will give us what we need to get back where he wants us to be. But we got to know when to run. We got to know when the ball is in our court and we have a decision to make. And we've got to be honest with ourselves about ourselves and honest about what God's will is for ourselves so that we know when to run and where to run. And beloved, the safest place that you and I can run today is to the Lord Jesus Christ. Not calling folk who don't know your God. Not calling folk who don't care about your destiny. See, this is all about securing and maintaining your destiny. I wish I could stay there and just unpack that. But God has a destiny for your life and for my life. We are here to fulfill his destiny that he's given to us. And fleeing youthful lust. Now, here's what it is. He says youthful lust, not just lust, but youthful lust. Because secondly, as we understand, not just running, but this whole youthful lust thing, is that the desires, and I want you to hear me closely, the desires that the enemy will tempt us with, they don't start when you get 56. They don't start when you get old. No, when you get old, you're still dealing with the stuff you did back in your teens and 20s. I want you to understand how the enemy actually still kills and destroys. He starts early.
Yes, he does.
He starts very early. And as an educator, I see it younger and younger and younger because kids are open. They're inquisitive. They want to learn. And that can be a positive thing. That can be a negative thing. But the enemy takes advantage of that open window, and he throws in cancerous seeds, all kinds of things that over time, it doesn't happen immediately, but over time, it will destroy you from the inside out. And the scripture is giving us some wisdom. He says, flee from youthful lust. Stuff that you haven't dealt with even from your past. And even if you and I consider myself young, wherever you are on the spectrum today, let me tell you something. I'm talking about our young people here today. Take it seriously where you are, because what God is saying to us today is that you don't want the enemy to have a stronghold of any type to any degree in your life. God wants you to be completely His. Sanctified at an early age. Matter of fact, the Bible says, remember your Creator in the days of your youth. So there is a principle here that God wants exclusive rights to how you develop, to how your mind is transformed, to how your will becomes reality. And even the flesh that is always bent against God, He wants to give you sustained victory while in this body of flesh, so that when you become an adult, you actually have a mind on your own to please God. You don't have to have a pastor or a preacher. You don't have to have a parent. You don't have to have somebody standing over you. But you can actually love God on your own.
That's right.
Flee youthful lust. And don't even let the enemy have the advantage at an early age. You know, many young people, they struggle with wrong ways of thinking, thoughts of being inadequate. It's real. It's very real. A lot of our young girls think they're not pretty enough, or their body type is not the right type, especially with our media, Instagram and Facebook and Twitter, and all these kind of images, and they think if I'm going to be accepted, I have to look like this, I have to have this type of hair, or I have to have this type of eye color, or my complexion needs to be this, or my figure needs to be like this, and I need to be able to present myself like this, like I see on this image here. It's image based. They measure themselves by images. They don't realize that the images they measure themselves by are insecure themselves. You can be as beautiful as you want to be. Doesn't mean that you're secure in heart. Doesn't mean that you're settled with who you are. And this is some of the strongholds that begin to develop within young people's minds and hearts. Thoughts of being inadequate. Thoughts of insecurity. And you know what happens? The young people who are insecure, they grow up to be full-grown people, adults, who are also what? Insecure. You see how this thing continues? God wants us to deal with these things now. And listen, beloved, by the way, you say, I'm not young anymore, Pastor. Well, let me tell you something. God can give you the grace right now. Just like He will that young person. He'll give you the grace right now to deal with those youthful lusts. You see, it's not your age that's the point this morning. It's a point of understanding where it started.
Yes.
And if you can go back to the origin of it, understand from God's perspective what the origin of it is, then God can give you the victory over it.
Oh, yes.
So that it no longer shapes who you are.
Amen.
But you actually have a virtue now of fleeing and running to the Lord rather than running or staying into those situations. Insecurity, lust, sexual lust, exploration, whatever it might be. All these things Satan will use. But Paul tells us to identify these problem areas and take them seriously and intentionally create space between ourselves and people who live this way. Going back to verse 21, he said, listen, in verse 20, he says, the beginning of verse 21, therefore anyone cleanse himself from the latter, cleanse yourself from those of dishonor. And for some of us this morning, it's going to call for us to actually do some things differently.
That's right.
Where we walk in a way, and first of all, begin to think in a way which says, Lord, where am I really at right now? And where are you taking me? Because I really want to be virtuous. I want to have a vessel that is honoring, pleasing to you. And help me to look around. Where am I at? If most of your associates as a Christian are non-Christians, you need to change your environment.
Talk about it.
Because you, according to this text, are surrounding yourself with
right.
vessels of dishonor.
That's right.
Now, God has called us. I want you to hear this. God has called us to be a witness and a light. So God didn't call us to live in a bubble. God's not calling us to be separatists in the sense of being exclusive. You just, you know, we don't have any dealings with. You're not saved. You know, no. But he has called us to be a witness and a light.
Right.
So, okay, in a decaying world.
That's right.
But here's the thing. If you and I are going to become a vessel that God can use, we have to dedicate ourselves to that process so that when God fills and pours into us and solidifies us and secures us, now we're able to be a light and a witness. A credible Christian. Not a crummy Christian, but a credible Christian. A Christian that has, listen, value within it, understands that value, is not willing to compromise that value.
That's right.
But a Christian that will go into the world and say boldly, this is who I am, and because Jesus has done this to me, he wants to have the same work in your life.
Yeah, that's right.
We can be a witness. The vessel that God wants us to be. That's what he wants to do in our lives. But he says, first, flee. The second thing he says is, follow or pursue. Look at verse 22. He says, flee, euphilos, but pursue or follow righteousness. Now he says several things here. I want you to look at it. Pursue or follow righteousness. In other words, run from, but run to. Philippians chapter 4, verse 8 says, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are good report, if there be any virtue, there's that word, and if there be any praise, think on these things. What is God saying to us today, beloved? Here it is. You got to know what to associate with. You got to know where to hang. Because God says, no, everything is not for you. Your environment is very important to your spiritual development.
Yeah.
Very important to your spiritual development. So follow or pursue, rather, righteousness. Fill yourself purposely. Surround yourself with people who are striving to serve God the same way.
Yeah. Amen.
Those that are endeavoring to be right before God. Let me tell you, that's so important because it helps you. We learn by association. We learn by those that we talk with. We learn by the connections we make. And if those connections are pushing us towards God's goal, righteousness, then we found a healthy environment.
Amen.
He says, pursue righteousness. But that's not all he says. Look at the verse. He says, goes on. He says, not only righteousness, but the second half of that righteousness would be this. And I want to unpack it this way. It tells us who to hang around, but that righteous word also gives us who not to hang around. Psalm chapter 1 says, blessed is the person, or blessed is the man, who walks not, what, in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scorn. Now, here's my 21st century translation. In other words, Paul is saying, hang around righteous folk. The flip side of that would be this. Don't hang around ungodly people to gain advice from them. Counsel. That's what that means. Advice.
Yes.
Where do you get, I think, Brother Robinson, you mentioned this earlier in Sunday school. When you get advice, and we're so easy to do that sometimes, we'll ask anybody, but I want you to stop and think before you actually open yourself up to receive something that's not the Word of God. The world will never tell you what God says. The world's counsel, as wise and as good as it might seem, will never tell you what the Word of God says. That's just a rule of thumb. Don't walk in the ways of the world or get counsel or advice from sinners. Your advice, first of all, should come from your prayer life. Secondly, it ought to come from God's Word. Then it ought to come from God's people. Why do we come to church? We need to hear what God has to say. This is not advice. It's actually instructions. And it works if we'll actually submit ourselves to it, open ourselves up to it. And on a daily basis, listen, don't get ungodly advice, or don't get advice from ungodly people, rather. Get it from God's people. Because they're the ones that actually understand where you are, because they're on that same process.
Amen.
Psalm 1 says, don't get advice from sinners. Don't entertain, secondly, the lifestyle of sinners. He says, don't stand in the way of sinners. That means simply we have adopted a lifestyle that is identical to those that don't believe. But thirdly, don't adopt the values of sinners. When I say adopt, it becomes yours. He says, don't sit in the seat of the scorners. Listen, then we become like them because we've heard their wisdom. We've observed their lifestyle. And now we've made a decision to become just like them.
Yes.
You say, preacher, I would never do that. All of us have said that. I'll never do that. But listen, the reality is, if we don't check these areas as the scriptures are telling us this morning,
It
will happen on its own.
Yes, it will.
Because that's how shrewd the devil is.
Yes.
That's how wicked the flesh is. Yes. And that's how strong the pull of the enemy is. So as we begin this year, let's pursue righteousness. Let's follow righteousness. But secondly, let's follow faith. And this word simply means faithfulness. Faithfulness. Not being a person that is unfaithful, but a person that is faithful, that is steadfast, that is committed, if you will. Pursue steadfastness and faithfulness before God and before people. Be a man or woman of your word. Be a man or woman that is committed to doing what it is that you need to do. In other words, live a committed Christian life. What is God looking for from all of us this morning? A committed walk. Don't live a double life. Don't be one way here, one way. No, live a committed life before God and be who God made you to be.
Yes.
Because that vessel needs to be just as honorable no matter where it's placed.
Yes.
Because God will take you into some devastating circumstances. But guess what he still needs you to be? A vessel of honor. He might take you into some dangerous territory, but guess what he needs you to be? A vessel of honor. That vessel does not change its character or its look or its purpose. That vessel remains the same no matter where it is placed. And God wants us to be faithful. That's who Jesus is to us. And that's who he wants us to be as followers of him. But the next word he says, love. Not just faith, but love. Show the love of Christ to others throughout your life. And through your life. Show the love of Christ. Attitude. We're talking about personalities in Sunday school. Let your attitude, your demeanor, the way you present yourself, the way you think, because what you think is actually going to come out on the outside. So be loving in your heart and allow God's love to flow through you. That's a vessel of honor. But that lastly, he says, peace. Live a satisfied, settled, surrendered life. A life that is surrendered to God is a life that has peace. A life that is peaceful is a life that is not easily uprooted. It's settled. You actually have stability and you're satisfied with Jesus alone. And you're satisfied to know that his perfect work is being unfolded in your life, and all you have to do is be still and let God do what he's doing in and through your life. It takes the pressure off of you. Here's the bottom line. It takes the pressure off of you. Why have anxiety and fear and despair? That is, you're doing too much.
Yes.
Young folks say, you're doing too much. That's exactly what God is saying. You're doing too much.
Right.
Actually, would you just rest in me and let me give you my peace so that wherever you are and whatever I'm doing in your life, you can just be rest assured that I have the master plan and I'm going to do it. And when I get through, your vessel is going to be a vessel of honor, a vessel that I can use. Because that's what he's calling us to do. He says, peace, at the end of verse 22. Peace with those who call upon the Lord out of a pure heart. Now he shifts now, not only to us, but he talks about fellowship. The last thing he says is fellowship. What to flee from, what to follow, but now how to fellowship. This is where we belong. Full circle. Where do we belong? Here it is. With those that call upon the name of the Lord. You get that? Where's your home? With those who know Jesus. What's going to benefit your life in 2017? That when you and I really get serious about this community of faith, and actually start using one another and helping one another to become what God wants us to be. It'll never happen without that. He said, listen, this peace is pursued when we actually understand that we need to be in community with those who call upon the name of the Lord. That's prayer.
Right.
Your closest friends should be people who pray with you. Pray for you. I'm not just talking about older people. No, I'm talking about people that you actually showed you. They need to be people who know how to pray for you. And then you need to be able to pray for them. And your closest relationship should be people who have a heart for God. You see, now, I said this is difficult because all of us have to now go back and search and see where we are.
Amen.
I didn't make this up. It's verse by verse in your Bible.
Yeah.
Which means that all of us this morning have to go back and say, Lord, search me.
Yes.
Because I can pray till I'm blue in the face. Lord, I want to grow. Lord, I want to be. Lord, I want to do. And God's saying, I've actually given you some stuff that you still haven't looked at seriously yet. Because every time I give you something, the enemy uses your associates to snatch it from you. How many times you've been in a church and heard sermons and heard the gospel, heard the truth, and go back to your environment and it is snuffed out like a thief comes in your house and robs you. You've been had. And God says you don't have to have that experience because what I'm giving you and what I'm doing in you, it can stick. But you actually got to do some work now. I'm not going to do this for you. Make sure your environment as believers is honoring to God, edifying to your own spiritual growth and development. And as we prioritize this, God then becomes able, unlike any time before. He becomes, and he's excited to do it because he wills to do it of his good pleasure. He has something he really wants to do in your life. I'm not joking this morning. But you and I have to let him. And it might mean that we might have to make some hard decisions. You know, you're my buddy, but you know what? You ain't going where I'm going. I got to make some tracks this year. I've been spinning my wheels, and I've been saying this, and you know, I ain't going nowhere. But this year in 2017, I actually want to do something for the Lord. But you got to make some decisions. You might need to cut some folk. In the love of God, love you, but we can't be that tight no more. Might be some good people. Might even be family members around, you know. But, you know, we got to make a decision for Christ holistically. And then God will give us the strength as we move through those difficult decisions that all of us have to make. All of us have to make. But here's the end result. God will do something in your life that will actually change those that are in your life. You see, unless we make this decision and commitment for God, we'll never be a light like he wants us to be. But once we say yes to Jesus and he becomes a priority, he then pours into us and makes us usable for every situation, for every relationship, for every family member, for every area of life and network that he'll bring us to. Because he wants us to be a vessel of honor. Lord, use me. Even if it hurts, use me. Father, I pray this morning that all of our hearts are open, not partially, but completely to the Lord Jesus Christ. And I pray this morning that, Father, you would show us even those areas in our personal lives that, Father, we have to make decisions on based upon what your plan is for our lives. And Father, once we make those decisions and once we make those steps, God, I pray that you would give us your peace. Peace that we have done what you told us to do. Peace that we are in alignment with your will, your plan, your desire. And then Father, may we see the fruit of it, knowing that you're going to use us far beyond our wildest expectation. And may this year be a year of growth, exponential growth. May this year be a year of unusual blessings. May this year be unlike any other we've ever experienced. And I pray that for every born-again child of God in this room. And before I close this prayer, maybe you're here this morning, you're saying, Pastor, you know what? On a practical level, that's where I am. I need the Lord to actually have exclusive rights to my life. But Pastor, there's some things, there's some desires, maybe in my own heart, maybe no one else knows about, but it's there. It's my own desire. I want to do that. You know, and be honest with it. But there's some things there in my heart. There's some people in my life. There's an environment that's not honoring to God. And you know what? I need to get that right. And I have the power within my own self to say no to that and yes to God because God is helping me right now. And Pastor, I want to do that. I want God to be glorified in every area of my life. I want to be a vessel through and through that will bring glory to God. Is there one today? Pastor, pray for me. It's difficult. I've got some issues, but I'm trusting God as I make this step. Is there one? Just raise your hand. I want to pray with you. I want to pray for you. And I want to pray God's power over your life, even as you navigate through these circumstances in your life. Because God is able to keep you from falling. And he's able to present you faultless. I see that hand. God bless you. Is there another? Preacher, pray for me. God has spoken to my heart. And I need his power every step of the way. I'm not going to be cocky this morning and think I can handle this. No, I need God's power and God's strength. Is there one? Preacher, pray for me. I want to pray for you. I do. I see that hand. God bless you. Be honest with God this morning, because if you're honest, guess what? Honestly, he'll help you. He'll help you in a greater way than you've ever experienced. Maybe secondly, you're saying, preacher, I'm a born-again believer. Give my heart to Christ. I know I'm saved. On my way to heaven. But today, I need to get back in fellowship with God so that he can continue to make me a vessel of honor. I've resisted the sanctifying work of God in my life, and I feel it. But today, I want to let him have his way. Let him have his way. Is that you? Just raise your hand. I want to pray for you. Preacher, pray for me. I want God to have his complete work in my life. God bless you. Maybe you're here today, you need to join this church. Or maybe you need to be saved. You've never given your heart to Jesus Christ. Come today. Come today. My time is gone, but God is not done with what he's doing in your life. Is there one? God bless you. All standing on your feet. Father, now I pray that you would bless this time of soul searching and responding to your grace. And I pray your blessings over us now in Christ's name. Amen.